The supplement industry is often known for its overly promising marketing of products and very expensive supplements. However, creatine is surprisingly enough not one of them. In fact, it's one of the most researched supplements out there, and studies have over and over again proven its effectiveness, and it's also one of the cheapest products out there. Now, if it's so effective and so cheap, is it actually safe? Creatine often gets associated with performance-enhancing drugs, since the benefits seem too good to be true. But I am here to say to you that these claims are completely untrue, since creatine can actually be found in most of your foods and is something that your body can produce naturally. Like for example, it can be found in beef steak and in herring, but it's just in such low dosage that you would need to eat more than half a kilo of raw steak or herring to get the same amount of creatine as in one small scoop of creatine monohydrate, and the thing is, you're probably still not consuming enough of it to notice the performance enhancing benefits of it, and you need to eat this every single day to keep it into your system, and cooking the meat actually even denatures the creatine, so it would be an even lower dosage. So it's needless to say that supplementing is probably the most effective way to go. Now, since it's basically in our food, it's almost safe to say that there probably won't be any health issues when supplementing it, but of course we still need to look at some studies to make sure of it. And there might also be one side effect of which some of you might fall subject to, over which I will go over in a minute. But first, let's go over these studies. One of the most heard claims about it is that it's bad for your kidneys and your liver, and that's mostly because it raises the level of another substance called creatinine. And this is often used to assess kidney or liver damage. But a rise of this substance doesn't actually mean that it is harming your kidneys or liver. However, if you have pre-existing issues with your liver or your kidneys, you might want to avoid this, even though there isn't really any study to prove this, but it's better to be safe than sorry. There is, however, one case report that's often cited against the use of creatine, and it's of a young weightlifter who supplemented creatine and had renal failure, but there were also other supplements involved, so it's not clear if it was caused by creatine or anything else, and this is just my speculation, but it could also be that in this case the person was using other performance enhancing drugs which can cause damage to your liver and your kidneys. And this is also just one study against thousands of other studies, and this is clearly not enough evidence. There was also one long-term study that looked at the effect of creatine supplementation on college football players, and they consumed from 5 up to 20 grams of creatine on a daily basis. However, after 0.25 to 5.6 years, there was no detrimental effect on liver or kidney function. So it's almost safe to say that there isn't any risk involved when it comes to creatine supplementation. Now, how should we use it to get the most benefits out of your workout? And for this, we need to look at how creatine actually works. As an energy source, our body mainly uses ATP as energy to produce force to move that weight. Now, ATP has three phosphate groups, and one of those groups is used to create that energy, which leaves ADP behind, which then again has two phosphate groups. Now, this ADP is pretty much useless and is more of a waste product, but creatine will give one of its phosphate groups away to that ADP, making it ATP again. And this allows you to create more energy over a short period of time, thus leading you to being able to do a few more reps because of the stored energy. And this is also proven because this clinical trial found that when people were using creatine, they significantly increased their strength more than people who didn't, suggesting that creatine allows you to increase your overall workout volume, which is one of the main drivers of muscle growth. So we know that creatine can improve your performance, but how much should you be taking? Well, there is a limit to how much creatine your body can store, so using more isn't necessarily better. When looking at the supplementation protocol of this review, when using a normal diet that has about 1 to 2 grams of creatine consumption per day, we know that these stores are filled up to 60 to 80%, so we need to supplement the remaining 40 to 20%. But our body doesn't really obtain all that creatine from one scoop, so we can use either what's called a loading phase of about 1 week, and in that loading phase you consume about 20 grams of creatine per day to get the benefits as fast as possible, and this would fill up these stores, and thus we can use that creatine optimally. But these stores will get drained over time, so we need to maintain it by ingesting 3 to 5 grams per day, and some high level athlete might need 5 to 10 grams. And this review also mentions that you can just start with consuming 3 grams per day, but the result of it will come way slower, so it would be most effective to just start loading that creatine right away. And if you happen to take a break from it, it takes about 4 to 6 weeks for your stores to return to baseline, so if you miss a day or two, you don't need to start loading up right away, since there's still plenty of left in your body. Now this means that it's probably best to take it every day for the rest of your training, and that you don't need to cycle it, even though a lot of people think that this is the best way. But there is still a lot of unclarity for most people of which creatine to supplement. Now there are some studies out there looking at the differences, and creatine monohydrate seems to always come out on top, despite the other products costing a lot more, and I won't really go into them in detail, but you can check out these studies in the link in the description, so you can make sure that what I'm saying is actually correct. Now the only reason you might want to look into other variants is when creatine upsets your stomach, which does happen to be one of the most common side effects. A study found an increase in stomach issues when athletes started supplementing creatine, so if this is the case, you might want to look for another form of this substance. Now as to what to take it with, most people think that it doesn't really actually matter, but that's not the case. This study, for example, shows that creatine levels are much more elevated when you're taking it with carbohydrates or with carbs and protein. There is a small difference, however, it's still a difference. And this would mean that it would be ideal to take it along with a protein shake, since they often also contain quite a few carbs and of course a solid amount of protein. You can also just combine this with your dinner, since you also usually eat quite a few carbs and protein during those meals. I usually just dry scoop it after dinner and wash it away with some water, but that's up to you. And as to when to take it in the day, there is one research article looking at the benefit of taking it pre or post workout, and it does seem to give more benefit to taking it post workout, however the difference is basically in the negligible. And especially when looking at the previously mentioned articles, it's quite clear that it doesn't really matter that much when you take it to get the desired levels of creatine storage. And there aren't really any side effects, other than that it might cause some men to go bald earlier than they normally would. Since one study found that when male rugby players supplemented it, it increased their DHT with 40%, and since DHT is one of the causes of hair loss, you might want to look out for it, but don't throw away your creatine quite yet, since there are also some other factors to look into. First of all, increased DHT levels doesn't necessarily mean that you're going to lose hair, because if that would be the case, everyone who takes creatine would walk around with a shiny head. This would only be the case if you're going to get bald at some point in your life, creatine just fastens up that process. So it's up to you if you don't care to just get bald faster, or if you still want to clamp onto your precious hair for a few extra years. I personally haven't seen an increase in hair loss yet, so I hope and I definitely think that I'm safe. But looking at your head a few times per year is something that you might want to do if you're going to supplement. Now it happens to be that not everyone responds to creatine. Some people don't really tend to take it up in their system, and this can be a bit frustrating, since well, you don't actually know if this is the case for you. A quick way to check this is to basically track your weight, since creatine does cause you to retain more water than usual, so if you're gaining a lot of weight rapidly, it's probably safe to say that it works for you, and if you're not gaining any weight at all, you might want to reconsider supplementing with creatine. However, since it's cheap and fairly easy to take, it doesn't really matter that much. Now, since it causes you to retain more water, there is a big misconception that it causes you to look more watery and fat and a little more bloaty. However, the water is actually going to be stored into your muscles, actually even causing them to appear a little bit bigger, so it has exactly the opposite effect of what you might think. Now thank you for watching this video, please remember to give me some feedback in the comments. I'm trying to get used to this YouTube thing, and every type of feedback is welcome. I put in a lot of days into making this video, so a quick like and subscribe is muchly appreciated, since this allows me to put out more content like this and help you guys on your fitness journey. So smash that like button, subscribe, and I'll see you guys later.